One question I have is that, you know, quite often you mention that we should have any endeavor we do, if we do it with a lot of focus and dedication, it kind of gives us a glimpse of spirituality or at least some sort of some divinity in that. But, you know, a lot of people like myself who are deeply steeped into science, yes, sometimes don't see it that way. For example, you mentioned that if you love music and you do music with total focus, yes, you feel an experience. Also, say you go to the mandir sometimes, you do puja with a lot of focus, or go to temple and pray in front of the murti, you get this idea of a very nice feeling and satisfaction. But you may also, someone might also say it's a divine experience. But if I look at it rationally, all I can say is actually, it's just a sense of satisfaction, and yeah, it just feels calm and good, and that's it. Why bring the word divine in that? Yes. This is a lot, people ask this question a lot. It's not a serious question, it's rational thought.
Very, very clear.
Rationally, yes.
Vijayabhai, you are absolute perfect rationalist, so I'm going to have a problem today with you, but never mind. The important thing is this: every activity we do that makes us feel more empowered, better about ourselves and the world that we encounter, is a sign that we are going towards our true nature, which is essentially not material, but something different from matter. And this is why it's called, the word we use loosely is spiritual. So sometimes the word spiritual appears very woolly, and people say, what do you mean by spiritual? I love music, but I say it. Why do you use the spiritual? Simply saying, because it empowers you, thrills you, that particular thrill cannot come out from just material enjoyment. There's something deeper that's vibrating, or kind of, in a way, reacting to that particular experience in a very positive. That's why you get a thrill. That's why people love music, or people love science. Science is like a jigsaw puzzle. When you fit in different parts, you get a thrill. When, like a jigsaw puzzle, you put the last bit in, and you go, yahoo! That thrill, you may think, is just material. Come on, it's just secular, you know, mundane. So what's the big deal? But in a way, it is gradually taking you towards a spiritual experience, or if you like, towards spirituality or your true nature. The other thing I must mention is this. Sometimes people say, look, this is one of the flaws of the Hindu tradition. Mm-hmm. We are highly sentimental people. We like this kind of wallowing in sentimentality. That's why all the soap operas are so popular. We love sentimentality. So sometimes people go into these temples and they feel that they are thrilled by the experience, etc. So sometimes they think, oh, but sometimes be careful. It should not simply be sentimentality. It should be a genuine love for spirituality. So unless it is genuine love for spirituality, don't get caught up by this pure sentiment. Hindus are very bad. They love to wallow in sentimentality, you know, go round and round the merry-go-round. So it is important for us to keep our feet firmly on the ground and be rational as you are.
Okay, I'm just to add a bit more on that question. I mean, you know, you mentioned this idea, but we also get a thrill if you go to a dance club at night. I mean, I'm dancing to Bollywood music. Is that spirituality as well?
I told you, I'm going to have trouble with this guy. He's asking very rational questions. You see, the difference is this. Any activity that makes you more focused is spiritual. Even if you say Bollywood, I'm telling you. Mm-hmm. Any activity that makes you feel scattered about yourself, your mind gets in a scattered state, like, you know, this loud music that blows your eardrums, surely there's no way to take you towards spirituality. Even though you are fully focused on it, it is a scattering experience. So any experience that in a way allowing you to kind of become more concentrated, more focused about your particular agenda is called spiritual. Anything that makes you more diversified or scattered is damaging. So it's taking you away from your true nature, which you can only be revealed through more, if you like, concerted effort towards becoming more one-pointed.
Okay. Thank you for the answer, Dilipbhai. Interesting question. Dear audience, please, if you like the question so far, try and put thumbs up for us, share, and also make some comments as well. Thank you. Next question I have as well is regarding, you know, the idea of idol worship and the murti question. It's quite a complex issue because Hindus say we don't worship murtis. We don't worship, sorry, idols. We actually worship a murti. Now, first question I have is that where does the idea come from? Is there any justification in the scriptures? Like, where is the idea of murti? What does it look like? Because I know in some of the ancient traditions, people used to believe that the stone itself has power, like something called parasmani. So, not the image, but I think the murtis as we worship is slightly different. But the question comes, is still never sure. People just go in the mandir and just pray to the murti without any idea at all what the murti represents, where is the justification, and what rules should be used to worship it. It's just Bow and go. So what are the rules behind? It's a bit of a messy question.
No, it's please, a very good question.
Please help me
on
this.
No, it's important, let's tidy up all these things. First of all, the word murti is derived from the Sanskrit root, giving a material status to something that is non-material, murta swarup. So murti is derived from the word that we are trying to offer a material manifestation to the idea of spirit. So it's a very clear idea that we are using, if you like, material object to relate to idea of spirituality. This is a meaning. Now, in the Vedic scripture, the times of Vedas, there were not many, in fact, there were no murtis at all. They were just doing havan ceremony. So murtis were not visible in the Vedic period. It's only after Buddhistic, end of Buddhistic era, that all these colorful gods and goddesses and all this imagery came into being. Let me be very clear with the Hindus. When somebody says you are idolatrous, that means you are worshipping objects because the objects have got magic powers. That's what it means. We do not do that. We never, in fact, sometimes Hindus themselves, you know, we are going to worship the idols. You are not worshipping idols. That means you are worshipping objects, marble and statues and all that. You are using these images or these ideas to relate to the idea of spirituality using, if you like, this kind of material form. And we are not apologetic about it. In every field, we use this kind of, some kind of icon to relate to some subtle idea. So we're not apologizing for it. Now, the other thing is this. You see, when I've been to many temples, look, I am not a temple guy, as you know. I prefer to think of God not in temple or in the images or in the heaven, but in humanity. So I struggle, basically, but I still go to the temples and watch. When, for example, there's time for darshan, you know, when the curtains go back and the image of the gods or goddesses are revealed, straight away, I look at the, forget about the images, I look at the devotees and their faces light up. Their eyes glaze over. They seem to be in presence of real divinity. So as far as the images are concerned, they're doing their duty, they're doing their work. The people are, you know, thrilled by it. So they are, in a way, very, you know, very positive thing for people who believe in this idea of worshipping God through images. Nothing wrong with it. That is part of Hinduism.
But an ancient question on that is that that's fine, worshipping murtis, as you explained, and somebody can focus on it. But it seems that there is no rules on what kind of murti there is, yes? People worship... Even some of the murtis, sorry, I'm not having a go, but some of the murtis are very strange looking, dark in color, you know, don't even a proper shape. Is that all okay? I mean, is it happy-go-lucky or...
This Hindu tradition is so open-minded, it is okay. Yeah. Look, if you are in a village, you don't have money to buy a marble statue or even install a statue. So, you know what they do during this kind of, you know, mother goddess worship, etc.? Yeah. They collect some leaves, some plants, some, you know, sticks, some thread, and tie it all together to make it look like Mother Goddess. Now, there's nothing like the poor Mother Goddess, but this is the best way they can show their devotion, you know. So they try and manipulate some kind of leaves and artificial, even stones they put in, color it, and it looks, for the outside, it looks very weird, but for the devotee, this is how he's pouring out his or her devotion. So be it. So we are open, but then this is the good part. They know that these images cannot last because they're made from sticks and stones, leaves and so on, or flowers. So what they do is, after 7 days of worship or whatever, they do visarjan. That means that they take those images and, you know, immerse them in the water, saying, okay, the job is done, goodbye. Because otherwise those images will, you know, will rot in front of their eyes. They can't allow that. So they immerse it in water and say goodbye. It's a very colorful way of relating to the idea of spirituality in a routine life.
Again, add a bit more, because I'm quite keen we tidy this up. I've also noticed that a lot of tribals in India, they tend to worship trees, not even images, because they see it as life-giving to them. Is that also okay, or is it seen as a form of worship? How would you see that?
It's wonderful to see that. Look, the modern ecological, the world that is so focusing on ecology and all that, we've been practicing it for thousands of years. We recognize it. This is the deeper philosophy of Hinduism. It says everything is manifestation of the spirit. Everything, including the material world. Not only human beings, animals, insects. Even the material world, the forest, the trees, the plants, the hills, the rivers, they're all essentially manifestation of the spirit, kind of, you know, setting itself up. So give divinity or give sacred status to everything. That is why the rivers are given the names of mother goddesses and so on. So we have been recognized, ecology is not new for us. We have recognized the divinity of the whole of the whole, not only the living kingdom, but the whole of the world that we encounter in front of our eyes, the material world too. There is nothing wrong. In fact, the world is now revisiting this idea of ecology, you know, dignifying the whole of environment is in a way relating to the same idea.
Thank you for the answer. I think it's a very good answer. I mean, is that the reason why, I mean, so
when you... when you say very good answer, it's like getting a tick from my headmaster before you carry on.
Just a question. Is that the reason why, say, Hindus... So I would just question, is cow a murti or something we revere, or a tulsi plant? Is it a murti or something we revere?
No, it's a living thing. Look, the reverence is as follows. It says, revere the whole of the universe that you encounter. The highest reverence is paid to human beings, men and women. These are the clearest manifestation of the spirit on earth. So we're saying, forget about God in heaven. Here's your God lighting everybody up, especially becoming more visible as men and women, human beings. We are the kind of apex of evolution. So they deserve special respect. Then we say, no, don't stop there. Revere the animal kingdom. That's why we look at all the animals and give them special status. And the cow especially got a very, very kind of, high marks, because it has stood by humanity, done symbiosis with mankind, so that mankind can settle down, start farming. And this is due to this lovely animal, the cow, that gave it steady supply of milk. This was a symbiosis, human beings living with the cow, it's fine. But now in the modern day and age, I'm discovering to my horror that this relationship became very lopsided. We are literally sucking the blood out of the poor cow, sucking the milk out of it. So it's now I'm saying it's time for us perhaps to even forget about not eating meat, but still stop it drinking milk as well. It's going to be difficult for me. But this is the way we are kind of this very lovely symbiosis we had has been severely compromised and become very lopsided. But we revere the living kingdom, and then finally we said the non-living things, we must revere them as well.
Okay. Oh, thank you so much for the answer. You've got quite a long question. Dear viewers, I hope you're still currently enjoying our show, and please stay with us. Please thumbs up again, and also please make comments, share with your family. Also, if you like our show, please let other family members know so they can join next time. Thank you so much for staying with us. One more question I have. This is from one of the viewers. It's quite an interesting question. Is that, we keep on saying Hinduism is very old, is one of the most ancient traditions. That's all well and fine, but surely the Hinduism we have today, the word Hinduism, I doubt that any early man even called it Hinduism. So was it Hinduism? I mean, how do you describe it? It seems so scattered in some ways. Although we try and put a focus, where did it start? How ancient is it? I mean,
okay.
Can you please help me on that question? Yeah.
See, initially, this is the story of human beings, whether it's Hindu from India or from other part of the world. In order for us to relate to the reality we encounter, the world that we see, we say, let us try and build relationship with the forces of nature that we see around us. So you see the Greeks doing it, and the Hindus were doing it, saying, oh, this is the sun god, and this is the the moon god, and this is the fire god, Agni, etc. So we are revering the forces of nature in order to build up relationship with them so we can get rain. Basically, it's just to worship them so we can get rain, otherwise we die. So we're trying to build relationship with all of this living, all the forces of nature. In fact, ancient Vedic scripture, nothing but praises to the forces of nature, personified. Fair enough. Mm-hmm. And then we evolved. So this is the origin, and I would say this started roughly about 5,000 to 6,000 years ago, because we see the rudimentary symbols in the archaeological evidence. So this, I would say, roughly 5,000 to 6,000 years old. And then it developed further. They say this is a very kind of materialistic approach to nature of reality. And then we encounter the idea that there is more to us than matter. That is when real Hinduism, we feel like spirituality, kind of so generated in ancient India. This happened, I would say, at least 1,000 years before Buddha. Because some of the ideas that Buddha adopted came out from this idea there is more to this life than meets the eye. Mm.
Okay. It's a very good answer. I mean, I think for rationalists, I kind of like that answer, the idea that maybe the early shamanist belief developed slowly and became core of Hinduism. But sorry to say this, for a lot of us rational people, yes, when we have a question saying that, oh, we are 1,000,000 years old, our scriptures are 2,000,000, it really puts a lot of rational people away. So I'm glad you tied this question.
Let me tidy this up. Because the Hindus like to exaggerate. Apart from being sentimental about everything, especially religious matters, we also like to kind of exaggerate tremendously. We say, we are 1,000,000 years old, Mr. Lakhani. I say, look, calm down. Homo sapiens, meaning thinking human beings, came on this face of this earth roughly 80,000. Maybe you can find some more degrees, 100,000 year old skeletons. Homo sapiens, very tiny human kind of standing on two legs and looking up. So this started about 100,000. We are Homo sapiens. It started 100,000. You can't be 1,000,000 year old. There's nobody here. Just, Neanderthals and so on. Hopefully you're not that. So please always keep your feet firmly planted on ground when you're talking about your religion. Otherwise, you exaggerate it out of, in a very outlandish manner.
Oh, thank you for elaborating on that. I just heard that we have a view all the way from South Africa, which is absolutely amazing. I would like to welcome Rabindra Gautam Shetty to the program. Thank you for joining us. Really appreciate you all the way from there. How far is nearly thousands of kilometers from us, surely. Okay, thank you for joining with us. One other question I have, this again, you see, when we need science and religion, it actually throws a lot of problems for a lot of people, including me. You know, we had the idea of multiverses, multi-universes. Now, just a hypothetical question. You know, currently I review the Bhagavad Gita. It's like the word of the Lord, yes? It's kind of universal, and also the teachings are such there's no moral code. It's really timeless teachings. The question I have for you is that, supposing we be reincarnated, supposing I die and I'm reborn again, maybe this universe, multi-universes, but it's the same Gita or something else?
Look, yeah,
I'm just trying to...
No, I understand.
Yeah.
Vijay, first of all, we don't want you to die. Please, don't rush. We are happy with you to don't reincarnate so quickly. Or don't go into near-death experience either.
Because you know the idea of the timeless world and the universe from science is different.
Just as laws of science themselves, you can say, are kind of eternal. It means as long as this universe is as it is, the laws will continue to operate. In the same way, there are spiritual laws that will be visible for as long as this world is there. But we agree that when, you know, we believe in the Big Bang, means the universe kind of opening up, space, time, and causation. We also believe in Big Crunch, when everything gets crunched up. Mm-hmm. Now, when Roger Penrose, my professor, in fact, said that maybe we don't have Big Bang, we have Big Bounces. Means they go, yoo-hoo, yoo-hoo. So maybe when it reopens again, the world, maybe the rules, the laws of nature may be different, the constants of nature may be different. And so even the rules of spirituality may be different. We are not fixed, oh, it's written up, you can't, when you are, there's a new creation, the laws will be, no, we don't know. They may unfold differently. So wait, we are open to this idea. Always be rational in the way you interpret your religion.
Oh, thank you. I think that's kind of makes me feel a bit better than before. Okay. We have a question also from Anju Panwar saying, it's a very interesting question. I hope you can help us answer that. Should Dharma be separate from politics? Because in some religions, they are seen as universal. I mean, how you describe also on this basis, how you describe Modi's rise to power?
Yes. It's a very, very important question. First of all, like it or not, I don't think there's more politics and spirituality can meet up. They are very difficult because politics is always a habit of compromising. So politics is a system of compromising. You can see everybody doing U-turns, all the politicians doing U-turns, whether like that, because the force, public force will push them. So unfortunately, the politicians have to keep compromising. So in a way, a person who is spiritual will say, no, not interested. In fact, lovely thing Vivekananda said, my mentor said is this. He said, please remember, it is not spirituality that has to pay tribute to society. Society has to pay tribute to spirituality. Mm-hmm. Spirituality is the superior aspect. So it is always going to be difficult. I give a very pointed issue. For example, with Mahatma Gandhi, people love him. And of course, I love him. He's a sincere person, done a great deal of good for humanity and produces this lovely magical tool of resolving human conflict in a humane manner, this idea of non-violent struggle. So he's brought wonderful ideas. I'll respect him for that. But again, you see, he was dabbling in spirituality and politics, and he made two major mistakes, which are really, worrying me tremendously, and I'm sure it worries a lot of Hindus too. First mistake he made is he allowed India to be partitioned. This has created tremendous hassle. The Hindus and Muslims were living well together, and the partition has caused permanent rift between them, and there is a permanent rift between them. It's not gone away. And these two poor nations are armed to the teeth to fight each other. So this was one of the biggest mistakes Gandhi made. He used the only one who could have said, no partition, we don't want independence, go away, British. We are not going to agree to your idea of partition. He didn't do that. That's one mistake. The second mistake he made, which are really very upsetting me, is he gave the whole dynasty of India to Nehru clan. Now, Nehru clan was atheist, agnostic, and so on, and they had very little love for spirituality, etc. And suddenly he's put in charge of a nation which is essentially spiritual. So there's a big disjoint, and this has created real problem for the last 50, 60 years after independence, because this nation went down the hill, one of the most corrupt nations in the world, because the wrong person was asked to rule that nation or kind of lead that nation. And I'm hoping now, as you mentioned, I'm not saying, oh, Narendra Modi is going to bring about the change. The nation is stirring up. The secular model he adopted does not suit his temperament. He's saying, I'm going to spit it out and adopt a spiritual model that suits our own temperament. So this is, if you like, the signal of the nation stirring up. And by this stirring up, they kind of create this lovely personality called Modi, who is not, the only perhaps politician in the whole world who has no 0% corruption in his system, is this gentleman. He doesn't, his mother is living in a hut. His brother is sitting in the back, kind of selling bananas. They get no special favor. And he himself, his own salary, he gives it away to the girl's education. This poor, never seen such a personality. So I'm hoping that this personality carries on and brings about a major change in India, which is very, very needed at the moment.
Yeah, thank you so much for answering the question. We have another question also from Guna Relinam. This is maybe very close to your heart. The question is that, is what it says, I am a deep follower of Swami Vivekananda, and I think he is the best after Adi Shankara and Ramakrishna Paramahansa. Would you agree with that view?
Hands up. If I don't agree, I'll be shot down. You know, I'll get a thunderbolt on my head straight. I have no choice. I have to put my hands up.
Right.
If you hear anything good coming out of these clips, remember, I'm an empty tin can rattling because somebody behind me, like a powerhouse, is making me rattle, and that person is Vivekananda. So I have nothing to say except yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Another question which is quite commonly asked is the idea of 10 avatars, yes? And we see that somehow Buddha is one of the avatars of Vishnu, yes? Yet I know the Buddhists, because I talk with them, they don't agree with that idea, but all the Hindus say is an avatar. So what is your view on that? It's a tough one.
It's a funny story. It's a funny story. You see, we love to, as I say, we like sentimentality. So suddenly within the Hindu tradition, we found a major reform movement popping up about 2,500 years ago, led by Buddha, who said all this unnecessary mechanistic ritual is unnecessary, animal sacrifice is unnecessary. And he came up with a reform movement within Hinduism that turned into Buddhism. Fair enough. So he's got his own kind of uniqueness, and so be it. Now, you see, the thing is, the Hindus said, how can we let this guy get away? So after Buddha, there was a period of severe atheism, charvaks. And the policy, the philosophy of charvaks was, eat, drink, be merry, steal if you don't get caught, good for you, and enjoy life. There's nothing more to life. This was the ruling idea 1500 years ago in India after Buddha. So Hinduism had disappeared. It had been replaced by severe, crass materialism. You might think, oh yeah, this is a very horrible story. We are in the same state today. Look at India today. What is the philosophy of India? Eat, drink, chase after these Bollywood girls, and that's it, life. Put some money in your pocket, don't get caught. Corruption. So you see, we are not that far from that particular difficult period. And that at that difficult stage, we have this kind of lovely personality of Adi Shankara, who revived Hinduism by going to the idea of Advaita. It means looking for a God in heaven, but seeing God in humanity. So this was the major transition that took place, which has in a way rescued Hinduism. Okay. So this is, if you like, the wonderful part, is an ongoing story.
Free e-learning course in Hinduism. To register, please visit www.hindu-academy.com.
Talks on Hinduism, sponsored by People Care, encouraging caring for the elderly in their own homes. For more information, please visit peoplecare.com.